Korean tariffs are significantly higher than the European tariffs. So the potential for the increase of exports to Korea, I think, is significant in many sectors, such as machinery, chemicals, processed agricultural products, and certainly cars. We certainly expect that this agreement, and we will come to cars later on, would also significantly increase the potential for access by European exporters of car and car parts to Korea. Second important element of the agreement is that the substantially new market access opportunities have been created across a broad range of services sectors, where it is telecommunications, financial services, environmental services, express courier, legal services, etc., etc. Actually, I would say that broadly speaking, the coverage of the agreement on the services sector is very similar to that of the agreement between the United States and Korea, although the method is different because we have followed the positive list approach and followed the negative list approach. The scope of the commitments is very similar in the two agreements, and obviously taking into account also differences of interest. And to give you an example, we have in the agreement a number of commitments by both sides to liberalize shipping services for reasons that would be very obvious to you. This is not something that is included in the agreement between Korea and the United States, but this is because this reflects a particular interest of the European Union and a particular sensitivity of the United States. Certainly, and this is quite a novel element of the agreement, in certain sectors which were particularly important for our trade relations with Korea, and where there was a strong concern by European industry about regulatory obstacles to trade, we came to the conclusion that it was necessary to negotiate some disciplines which applied specifically to those sectors. And that's the reason why the agreement includes I should never forget chemicals, that was an important issue for Korea. So the agreement actually includes four sectorial annexes, including specific disciplines to deal with non-tariff obstacles to trade in the automobile sector, in the electronic sector, pharmaceuticals, and chemicals. Now, I will not enter into the details of what is provided there, although I will say a few words later on the issue of car, because I think that inevitably is the question which has attracted a greater degree of political attention. The agreement also is very comprehensive in terms of developing disciplines and rules in a number of areas which are not covered or are not sufficiently covered by the WTO. So you will find in the agreement chapters on things like competition policy, regulatory transparency, intellectual property rights, a particular focus on the enforcement of IPR rights, labor, and the environment. Now, on many of those areas, the approach in our agreement is similar to that in the US agreement. There are some differences, but quite frankly, I think that differences which do not, which does reflect somewhat differences of approach, but do not lead to any significant question of conflicts between them. I mean, it is no secret that obviously the most sensitive sector in this negotiation has been the car sector. So we actually work very closely with the European industry to try to be sure that we reach a result that was fair and which provided, on the one hand, improved market access opportunities for European car exporters. And I said, the European Union is a significant car exporter to Korea. I think that currently European manufacturers represent about 56% of total imports into Korea in the car market. And the share of the European Union producers in the Korean car market is 3%, which, by the way, is also the share of the Korean exporters in the European car market. So the outcome of the negotiations was, from our point of view, balanced. On the one hand, we negotiated a reasonable period of adjustment for the dismantling of the tariffs, which is 3 years for large and medium cars and 5 years for small cars. This, we believe, is reasonable in terms of allowing sufficient adjustment time. You will, of course, be aware that the European tariff on cars is significantly higher than the U.S. tariff on passenger cars. Our tariff on cars is 10%, the U.S. tariff on cars is 2.5%. Secondly, we very much develop a novel approach, developing close cooperation with the industry to tackle technical obstacles to trade. Basically, this is an approach based on equivalence. It implies that Korea accepts for a list of regulations in the field of safety, equivalence between the Korean regulations and the international regulations that have been developed in the framework of the UNTC setting. And this includes all those regulations that the European industry has signaled to us are significant obstacles from the point of view of market access. For other regulations, there is a transitional period of 5 years over which Korea will be harmonizing its domestic regulations with the UNC standards. And then for some other regulations, there is no particular regulatory action by Korea, but there is a commitment that it would not be applied in a manner that represents a market access obstacle. And this is because these are regulations that when we discuss them with the industry, they seem to us that it did not represent a significant problem at this point. A part of that, we also developed a number of disciplines relating to environmental regulations. In the case of the standard that is more significant from the economic point of view, on board diagnostics, Korea accepted equivalence between the European standards and the Korean standard after the transitional period, and there are some provisions which apply during this transition. And in the case of emission standards, we have a provision which are very similar to those which were negotiated in CORUS, and which imply derogation from the application of emission standards for small sales manufacturers. Apart from that, the agreement also includes commitments relating to the non-interaction of new non-tariff obstacles in trade, and there is also an accelerated dispute settlement mechanism. Now, this approach is not the same one that was followed by the United States. Quite frankly, I don't think that that has any particular significance, other than necessarily there was not the same identical interest of U.S. manufacturers and European manufacturers. Some elements of the policies probably are very satisfactory for U.S. manufacturers. It would not have been really very valid for us. And some issues that the United States strongly and actually managed to get quite a good result, I think, in our agreement on the issues of taxation. We did not pursue because there are issues which exceeded our competences as trade negotiators. So our provisions on guarantees are not identical to the ones which are contained in CORUS, but I would say that essentially takes into account that we don't have exactly the same profile of exporters to the Korean market. Now, quite frankly, the issue that has been most difficult in these negotiations has been an issue which, paradoxically, I don't think is really a very complicated issue when the CORUS FTA was negotiated. This is the issue relating to rules of origin and duty rollback. My understanding from conversations I've had with colleagues in the US if that visit would ever become very difficult or very sensitive in the face of the US-Korea negotiations, for a number of reasons which I will not necessarily enter now, particularly since I think this is going to be reported, I will not report that.